missed there by this man, Afolabi Okiki. Sunshine, Odunlami almost hitting an own goal there, but it was saved. The post saving him from back, of course, mouth lash, if I put it that way, from his man. And this time it was Ojo with that pile driver off a shoulder, but it was alone, Daddy. Yes, it was. And I went away from target again. Tried as much as the goalkeeper dived, not giving anything to chance, but it was the head of a Yimba defender that took that away. Sunshine came attacking again, and this time not good again. It was a Denny's short that had the goalkeeper not taking any chances, and the goalkeeper Femi Thomas put that into corner, surviving it on the last day. Short form range there. Good free kick, a good goalkeeping, but it's corner kick. It's a Kingsley, it's a Denny rider that took that one, searching for his 17th, but not to be. Abe, and it's end of the match here in Lagos. Sunshine have failed to get the desired goal that would give them the continental place. And coach Kennedy Boboye, it will be a surprise if he is if he's on the bench for Sunshine next season. Looks like Sharks are the team that will join Taraba United, Bayelsa United, Kwara United, and a relegation to the lower division. Only team that could not swim out of the relegation waters. The celebration is on. The chairman of the LMC right there, the vice president of the Nigeria Football Federation, Seyi Akinwumi, right there, and of course the secretary of chief executive officer of the league also there, as well as the governor of Abia State, Igbazu. We also have Ifeanyi Uba, proprietor, also there. So the trophy yet to make its way to that position where the players are. And there you have it, Enyimba International, champions of 2014-2015 Global Premier League season. What a season it's been. They started very well, consolidated in the second round, and this man, when strikers were failing, he rose up to the occasion. Chinedu Udoji, and like a steal, he made Enyimba's defense very, very tight, conceding.
Congratulations to Enyimba doing the job there over Sunshine. Goalless draw, so sadly for Sunshine, the team that I support, Cecilia.
I didn't know you were supporting
them. Yeah, tickets for them. They needed to win that
to
game.
Have a chance.
Exactly, to have a chance. Because they were expecting Nasarawa United, because they were thinking, okay, if Nasarawa get to beat Giwa, and of course they get to beat Enyimba, it was more like mathematical and all that. They get to play in the CAF Confederations Cup. But at the end of the day, they just couldn't get that goalless it ended. And for Enyimba, they were actually rooting for 70 points. And as usual, goalless, they were satisfied with that
what
point.
Is, what do you mean as usual?
They spoiled the party for Sunshine.
You need a particular victory to just have your way.
Okay.
I mean, and they achieved that. That's what I
so
mean.
So you're not suggesting they play a lot of goalless draws?
No, that's not suggesting. Because against Warriors, they needed a point. Of course, at least a point to give them the trophy. And of course, they got that. Against this one, they wanted their 70 points, man.
And
of course,
they got the result.
Incredible. So that's how to do it.
Yeah.
So Super Eagles, just do that again tomorrow and get to the main stage of qualifiers. Where Chinase Eboyans joins us now from City FM. Well, he's here in the house. Chinase, good morning.
Good morning, Cecilia. How are you doing?
Great to have you on the show.
Always a pleasure.
All beaming with smiles, definitely. There's so much to talk about, as always, on the show.
As always, a lot. Monday mornings after the whole weekend, everything. So there's always a lot to talk about from the papers and generally just from the world of sports. Okay,
right,
so
let's start
with our sporting life. Of course, the very big headline, you can see, Siasa, thanks God. It was because of what happened on their way to Gambia for their training tour ahead of the under 23 championships in Africa. And they had to make a quick detour because the plane, a little problem. And he said something about the experience of the pilots who had to let out some fuel while they were mid-air to lighten the load on the plane so that they could actually make that landing, because they were not getting to the altitude they needed, you know. So sort of, I know how traumatic it must be for Siasia and his players, because you could tell he was really, really relieved after the whole experience and everything. So thank God it was nothing tragic. We're able to just go through that, and they are in Gambia now. As we speak, so they've gotten to where they're going to, and apparently start preparing for the under-23 championships that will determine who will qualify for the Olympics. So good one for the golden. I almost call them golden. That's the under-23 team. I don't like calling them the dream team, because I think the last dream team we had was just it was Monica giving to the 96 team. Since then, everybody has been dream team 2, dream team 3. No, it's the under-23 team. You know, the dream team was just one special team.
They'll definitely have it back.
Nah,
so we have to win it again so that we can start calling.
Not really. We just have to look for another moniker for them. I think the dream team is supposed to be for a special group of players,
like really where
you have, you know, like the Barcelona team of 92, talking about the American team, the US team. That was where the moniker was first appended to a team, because of the kind of players they had. It was a team you
yeah, it was really you, a dream,
dream team, right? Team you select, then like, oh wow, this is what I want. I want to pick a team.
So you can say the same for the 1996 Olympic squad for Nigeria.
Yes, that was. That was why it was that. That's why they picked up the moniker too.
So
but after
you
then,
don't believe this
since then, it's been the under-23 team, the Olympic team. I don't know why we keep saying dream team. For me, I think that's not. Okay, let's go straight to Sports Day, where the headline there is FIFA rejects Abuja for second leg. We heard the NFF were trying to move the venue for the fixture from Port Harcourt to Abuja, but FIFA said it wasn't within the 10 days they were supposed to give, the 10-day notice they were supposed to give. So apparently we are going to be in Port Harcourt. We have to play that game in Port Harcourt. And like why you were saying, let's just hope we get a victory, because we saw what happened to, let me start with Gabon. You know, against Mozambique, we felt that it would be an easy one after going away, losing 1-0. They had to wait, they had to go to penalties. Yes. And we wouldn't want to see that in Nigeria. We don't want to go to penalties. Then we want to make sure we settle that in 90 minutes. But the thing is that in African football now, there is no small team.
No.
Like you said, Comoros, Senegal, Madagascar, Chad defeating Egypt. Come on.
It shows you that.
Algeria and Tanzania playing a 2-2 draw. So it shows you that there are no minnows in African football anymore. Some people will also tell you, because I was watching the game with some friends, man, and maybe it's because of the physicality of the game in Africa, and referees tend to allow some things get they let some things go, because they are like, hey, come on, it's a man's sport. So this so-called minnows, I think they play that to their advantage. You know, they are always on the players, you know, harassing them and everything. And if you don't get your way, if the referee doesn't seem to pay you any mind, then you have to pull up your socks and get in, you know, get stuck in.
Okay.
So that's what's been happening.
That brings me to the question of Tai was saying, talking about the fact that maybe coaches will just have to use only home-based players, because they understand that physicality here in Africa when they're playing qualifiers. Would that really be cool? Or maybe like 90, let's say 75%.
But I understand what I was trying to say, but if you use this home-based players and you qualify for the tournament proper, would you now still use home-based players
to go for them?
Would you now abandon them? That's where we have to find a balance. That's why we have to use both the home-based players and the foreign-based players. There has to be a fine balance so that at the end of the day, I think if you have a philosophy of football, your own style of football, I don't think you would be too perturbed about how the other teams play. You just have to find out how you can find a way to block some of their own tactics. So I think physicality or not, if you have a certain way of playing, it will always work for you. Yeah. Some more times than not. So I think we can have a fine balance of the home-based and the foreign-based, but we don't necessarily have to have it all.
That was actually a response to Cecilia saying players are scattered all over the world. That's why they don't get enough time to actually, you know, get the blend and the necessary cohesion.
To stay for
like
a month play well. Together.
I'm like, that's not an excuse.
That's not an excuse.
It's not an excuse at all.
They are professionals. Like they're professionals. They play. They play for different clubs. They train, you know, and so you already have that mindset, so that when you come into the team, you should have that adaptability to be able to just, you know, take in what the coach is going to tell you. Let me give an example. There are players who play for other nations that are for their clubs. They play play different positions, or when they come back to the national team, they have certain positions. It won't tell me because they've not been playing this position in their club, they don't know what they should do. It's a matter of adaptability. They're able to come in, quickly grasp what the coach is saying, and translate it into the pitch.
Check the countries actually ruling the world football right now. They're the teams that have actually been together. Germany, Spain.
Belgium.
Yes. Most of them are in England. Where do you pick them from?
They're scattered all over Europe.
Seven of the Germans' key players are in England.
The Belgians, you mean?
Yes.
Lukaku, Hazard, De Bruyne just came in. So, see, I don't think that's business.
Let's talk about complete sports.
This is what Olise Banks of Port Harcourt fans. Of course, he doesn't have a choice now because after the Abuja venue has been rejected by FIFA, you have to stick with Port Harcourt. And definitely, he believes the fans will come out and show massive support to the Super Eagles. It's going to be a weekday, so maybe there might not be that much, but you know, it's football. Nigeria are football crazy. I think any time of the day, any day of the week, rather, you have Nigerians at the stadium to watch football. And so Olise should be able to bank on the Port Harcourt fans. They will come and they would support them. They will show support in full regalia.
We've seen it in recent games that the Port Harcourt fans are really passionate.
I don't even understand why. So, I'm just saying, this is your personal opinion. I don't understand why you wanted to move it from Port Harcourt to Abuja. Because most of the games we've seen in Abuja, the stadium is not full.
It's not always full,
the stadium in Abuja. So exactly. I think Port Harcourt, where they've been playing for some while now,
Port Harcourt,
Quaibom, Calabar, I'm talking about where you see the spectators will be actually there. It will be filled to the brim. So I think they should stick with Port Harcourt. Would actually work.
Okay. Sporting Sun.
Okay. Let's go away from football now.
Okay.
Lamar Odom suffers brain damage and...